Well, I think by now you have your attention. I have your attention. This is a real serious topic I want to talk about because it's really something going on the Dutch agricultural soils. But let me ask to start with a few questions. Who of you thinks he's eating in general healthy food? Quite a lot. Yeah, just you think. And who of you buys vitamins or minerals sometimes? Almost the same. That's a bit strange, isn't it? Because if you eat healthy food, it should not be necessary to buy these minerals and vitamins. It should be all in your food. But I can tell you it's not. What we've seen in the last 100 years, that the nutritional value of our food is really dropping. If you look at this, an apple, compare from 1910 to 2015. It contains 2 times more calcium, but 6 times more magnesium, 6 times more phosphorus, and even 23 times more iron. So nowadays, you should at least eat six apples before you have the same nutrition in the amount you get in. Broccoli, since 1989, went down with 60% in folic acid. And folic acid is one of the most important vitamins, especially for young children. Since 1989, that's not even 25 years ago. So, in Holland here, we talk about plofkippen. The Dutch people know, but to translate it into English, I'd like to call it puffy poultry. I've been thinking about it. It was difficult to find an English translation, but we talk about puffy poultry. But here, in this case, I would like to talk about puffy vegetables and puffy fruits and puffy potatoes. There's a lot of kilos we use and we eat, but no nutritional value. So it's filling us, but not nourishing us. And for me, that's scary shit. Let's say it's alarm phase one. That's why this siren. If you see what we spend nowadays on our food in Holland, it's about 12% of our net income is what we spend on food. Where if you look at 50, 60, 100 years ago, it was 50% or even higher. Is that prosperity? Yes, you can buy a lot of other nice stuff. But in the same time, in Holland, we spend about 75 to 80 billion euros on healthcare, with expectancy that it goes up to 140, doubling up in 2025. I don't know if that's prosperity. There's been a guy who lived 2,500 years ago. His name was Hippocrates. And all the doctors nowadays, they're still giving an oath to him about taking care of the patients. You know what he said 2,500 years ago? The quality of bread and food is a direct influence of our health. How can he, who doesn't heed this or doesn't understand this relation, understand the diseases that seize us? Think about it. He knew this 2,500 years ago. Nowadays, we forget all about it. Nobody knows it anymore. Healthy food is not coming from jars, taking pills or liquids. You have an ultimate example. I don't know if anybody of you seen the documentary Supersize Me. Do you know this? A guy tried to live on McDonald's food for 1 month. Mr. Spurlock. What was his name? Morgan Spurlock. He gained in 1 month 11 kilos and he suffered a lot of ailments. And it took him 14 months after stopping this to regain his old weight and get rid of his ailments he has gained in only 1 month. 2 years ago, I was talking to a dietist. Because especially it was a dietist of my wife, she had some strange, let's say she's not feeling well all the time, although we think we eat well. And she gave us suggestions what to eat and how to eat. But for one reason or another, it didn't work always out as they expect. And when I mentioned this fact to her, she said, okay, now it becomes clear to me. There is something seriously going on. But we, as a dietist group, don't know this. At least she didn't know. And never, no of her colleagues talked about it. And it opened her eyes. And only last year, beginning of last year, 2016, it was the first time that in a conference of doctors, the question came up, shouldn't we look at our food? Maybe there's something on there. You know who knows this exactly, this situation, who are measuring this and analyzing this for already for more than 100 years? That's the pharmaceutical industry. They know exactly what's going on. And why do they do this? Because they want to predict in how many years you need some magnesium, you need whatever, zinc, vitamins, so they can make it for you. They're not looking at how to prevent come to this situation. No, they just make something new for you to buy, because it's their business. That's what they're living off. How did this all happen? Just a brief glance back in history. The end of the 1900s lived a guy, Justin Liebig. He was a German scientist, chemist, and he has been analyzing plants. And he found out that if you mix nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium in the right amount with water and air, you have a good fertilizer, you can grow the plants, and the farmers have a guaranteed good income. But a couple of years later, when he got access to new analysis methods and more accurate methods, he found out that it was not only NPK, nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium, it was a lot more minerals. But his whole rectification was blocked by the industry. They didn't pay any attention about it. There were no internet at that time, so nobody paid any attention to it. It was just stopped where it was, making the NPK. This went on in history, but we can see a very clear turnaround after the Second World War. What has happened then? During these wars, the First War and the Second World War, a lot of production of the ammunition, explosives came up. And all these huge industry, they were making these nitrates formulations, like ammonium nitrate, potassium nitrate, as accelerants to make the explosives. After the war, that was not necessary anymore. So they tried to find a good use for these products. And of course, already Justin Liebig said, we had the N, the nitrogen, the P and the K. So why don't we make all these NPK fertilizers then? Because also the world population is growing, and we need more food to feed all these people. In itself, it was a good idea. And when that all started, at the same time, you could see that the industry, because what I have to go back. There's one thing I forget to tell you. Before that time, the farmer was only busy working on his soil to keep his soil healthy, because his healthy soil was giving him a guaranteed income. He paid all the attention for that. And the crops he selected, the varieties, were only selected based on the resistance against diseases. Because if it was, the crop became sick, there was no yield, there was no income. So he only took the varieties who were strong. And when this whole, after the Second World War, all this fertilizer industry came up, there was a second stream coming up, and it was the breeding companies who selected and the varieties of crops in the direction of higher yields. And the more fertilizer, the higher the yield, very good. You can have more kilos. That was the whole idea. But they forgot one thing. You make these crops, when these higher-yielding crops, they were weak for the diseases. They were vulnerable for diseases. One another thing going on, these fertilizers we used at that time, it became more and more and more, and in the first 20, 30 years was nothing, no problem. The soil could cope with that. But all these fertilizers are based on salt. And I don't know if any one of you tried this experiment where you put salt on snakes, on snail, sorry. And did anybody do this? Try this? On snakes. You see what happened? Ivo, you see what happened? Well, I can tell you the same is going on in soil. You put a lot of salt on the soil, but the whole soil is a living organism. And you do something with it. And I told you the plants got weaker, more vulnerable for diseases. So what's happened? Another industry came up making these plant protection products. They make fungicides, antibiotics, insecticides to help the plant to survive. But it's not going on the plant itself. It's also going out in the soil. Like I said, the soil is I see this soil as a living bioorganism. I compare it actually, the soil, to our digestion system. We, the humans and the animals, they have a very complicated digestive system, who is really depending on the bacteria and the fungi in your stomach and in your intestines. A plant doesn't have that. He is only relying on what he can get from the soil. And also in the soil, you need the biological activity to get the nutrition from the soil into the plant. Actually, the soil is doing what our intestines are doing for us. Another question for you. Did any one of you ever use antibiotics? Yeah, a lot, of course. Do you feel any problems with that? Sometimes, some people have diarrhea, some people are bloated. Another guy or a woman is have flatulence. Well, I can tell you, the soil has the same problems, the same symptoms, all at the same time. There's diarrhea because it's leaching out. It's constipated, it's fixed to the soil, a lot of nutrition. And it's farting like hell, biogases into the air. And so what we see now, nowadays, and if there are any farmers here, I think they can agree what I say. In the last couple of decades, when a farmer buys his plow together with his tractor, 5 or 6 years later, he needs a more heavy tractor with more power to pull the same plow through the soil. How's that? This means that there's something going on in the soil. The structure is going down. Because what they do, they want to make cheap as possible this food, and they need more power to bring it on fast and take it off fast. So what you see, this kind of pictures. Like funny for us. I'll tell you, a few are not really happy with these. First of all, the farmer. It can take him hours, maybe days, to get these tractors out. But compared to what we would experience and looking at the soil, you see this. These kind of structures and destruction is going on in the soil with all these heavy machinery. And this takes at least as long as to rebuild this in a soil. It is not done in 1 year. It takes 5, 6, maybe 7 years to repair the structural loss in the soil. You just saw what's happening in these tractors. So the workability is going down. And another thing, 2 years ago, also 2 years ago, I don't know why, but was a farmer, he was calling me. He was a bit worried, he was really concerned. Because he said, well, I know that I have to do something on the soil, and I tried something. But now the birds are eating my soil empty. They're emptying my soil. I said, how is that? He said, well, now I have all these birds behind my tractor plow. And they didn't have that. And for me, that is scary shit as well. Alarm phase two. That a farmer who is responsible for producing our healthy food does not even know what is natural and what's not natural. That scares me. Because the soil is not empty where all these birds are. There is a lot of nutrition in that. But he thinks it's natural, and the best is that there are no birds. Did you ever think about what we really ask farmers to give us when we buy something from them? Does any one of you think or thought about it? Probably, yeah, you've thought about it. Maybe you want vegetables. Well, I can tell you, we ask them to supply nice-looking products against the lowest cost. So the only thing they do is produce our food for the lowest cost possible, meaning more heavier equipment. No labor, because labor is costing a lot. They have to spray a lot plant protections products, because that's keeping the plants nice looking. But inside these crops he is producing for us, the nutrition is gone. 1 year ago, I was in Finland, and a guy called me and he said, well, I'm a potato peeler. He's peeling potatoes for big organizations like the military or hospitals. And he had a question, because one of his farmers supplied him some potatoes with an experimental. He put some foliars on it, and he had potatoes who were more round, less deep pits. So he said, I have 5% peeling loss, where normally I have 15% peeling loss. And he wanted to know what was going on. So I was talking to him for a few hours, actually. We walked around. And in the end, I asked him, now you gain 10%. You have 10% less loss. Do you pay your farmer a bit more? Do you know what his answer was? And it shocked me. He said, no, I'm not paying him more. I know what he can do now. Next year, when he's doing it the other way around, he's paying less. He's getting less. Another example, here in Holland last year, a wheat grower. He was talking to his buyer. He wanted to buy the products. And his buyer said to him, now you have to make me good baking quality. And the farmer said, yeah, well, okay, I can do that. But it's more work, because I have to fertilize it more frequently. And the total amount of fertilizer I can use is less. So probably the yield will be less. Do you pay me some more about then with it then? The answer was no. I want you to make the baking quality, but I'm not paying you more. How is this possible? Everybody knows that when you have higher quality, you pay a bit more. Not in the agricultural business. The farmers are really pushed down on prices. On the other hand, they have the government telling them that they cannot use this product anymore or that product anymore. They have the environmental issues. So they put pressure on them from both sides. They are under pressure of price, doing as cheap as possible. On the other hand, they are not allowed to do all these things anymore. Actually, in Holland, when you want to be a farmer, you have to be an ideologist or a masochist. Otherwise, you wouldn't start to being a farmer. Is this only a negative story? No, luckily not. We can make a difference. We have the possibilities to do this. We've seen this now for the last 15 years when we are working in this market. There are possibilities to turn this around. And people who are really working on it, they should start the whole management on the farm. And it always starts at the soil. Looking in the soil, what is the soil? How does it look like? What is the structure? How can we improve this? And only when you have the soil in a better state, you can make better products. We have examples of farmers who've been working with this for 15 years. And he's on a very heavy clay soil. I don't know if this means anything to you, but if you are on a heavy clay soil, nobody thinks about not plowing. Because when the winter is not coming in, you have all these big lumps and you have to freeze, so you have to plow it. Well, this farmer is not plowing anymore for the last 5 years. He even sold his plow. In this new climate change, where you have these longer dry spells or these very heavy rainfalls on these clay soils, he doesn't have any problems. After heavy rainfall, he can go out in the field 2 or 3 days later, whereas neighbors should stay away for two or three weeks. When you have a dry period for 2 or 3 weeks, he hasn't used his irrigation system for the last 5 years. So it is possible, but it takes time. What we have destroyed in 70 years' time since the World War, Second World War, you cannot repair in 1 year. It takes time. It takes 5 to 6 and maybe even 10 years to get really success in that. But it is possible. Another thing, what he sees now, his crops are more healthy. You've got more nutrition in it. He's got 40, 50% more minerals and vitamins in his potatoes. He's a seed potato grower. His seed potatoes, when he's planted out for the next year by other farmers, they give a higher yield. He got more kilos from it because these seeds, what you put in the soil, they are stronger. They're more nutrition in it. And another very important item, the quality of his products are much better and stronger. It can stand longer shelf life. We have seen examples for broccoli, for example, we've tried. We can keep a broccoli healthy and nice looking 3, 4, sometimes 5 days. This means a lot. If you look at what the supermarkets are throwing away every day, because it's not looking nice anymore, they just throw it away. But if we could give it 3 or 4 days more shelf life, they don't have to produce that much. Just keep it longer and we can sell it. So instead of producing more, I would say we produce the same but with a better quality. We can feed more people. This whole story is not a plea for biological farming. Maybe it looks like that. No, it's not. Because we still have to feed all these people on the earth. And to be honest, I don't think it is possible by only biological farming. What we are talking about is using the mainstream farming, agricultural farmers, but using biological insights. What's going on in your soil? How can we improve this? And if you do that, you still have the same yields, but with a much better quality. And it starts looking at soil, make a soil analysis. What are the chemical, what is the chemical balance in the soil? After that, what can we do to fertilize it? And how often do we fertilize it? And then in the end, what kind of cover crops do we need? What is important? And I don't know if you know what I mean with cover crops. In Holland we call it green fertilizer. That's the crops you put out on the field to keep it green during the winter. There are a lot of possibilities to do that. And you do it all right. Like this example I just gave you, this farmer is using only 50% of the fertilizer he has used 15 years ago. Still the same yield. The plant protection products also, not even half. He still uses some because sometimes you have to correct, but as far as not as much as what his neighbors are doing. Well, I'd like to close it now. There's one thing. You can forget everything I just said. I want you to remember one thing. You can only grow healthy food on healthy soil. It's impossible to grow healthy food on a sick soil. And the farmer is not doing this by himself. He is just doing what we are asking him to do, to supply nice-looking products. We should change our request to the farmer. We should say to the farmer, I want you to make high-quality food instead of only a lot of kilos who's nice-looking. Maybe we pay him 10 cents per kilo of potato more. He can do a lot with that. But nowadays, it's not possible. But it is something we should start working on. The consumer is the one who can only change this by asking other things. And one more remark. I really would like to thank Zetadek, because we know a lot about this, but it's also due to all the work and labor what Zetadek put in to help us to get all this information. Menno, thank you. Thank you very much.